The title of my talk, Transforming Our World, a Proposition, has two aspects. One of them is about diagnosis. The main idea being that our world is transforming in a very deep sense. The second aspect is about what to do about it. So how can we contribute as actors to this transformation process, and specifically as researchers? My ideas for both the diagnosis and the action are deeply based in STS research. Therefore, I'm very happy here to present some of my ideas and having been invited by the organizers. I will start with the diagnosis. The world has accepted 17 sustainable development goals. This is quite an achievement if we think about it. And for me, this is a recognition of the fact that the world is transforming. The fact that all the nations of the world accepted these ambitious goals. The problem with it is that these goals are embedded in a system, in a bureaucratic system of thinking of how to accomplish them. They are translated in targets and objectives, and then nation states report on whether they achieve them. There's nothing wrong with this process of voluntary reporting, but it tends to lead to a ticking the box exercise. So if you look at these country reports, they will argue that they have these and these policy measures in place to achieve these goals, and that's it. But if you look at the UN documentation and the underlying discussions, you can see there's a strap line to the SDGs. And the strap line is transforming our world. And my proposal is that this is the lens through which we should look at the Sustainable Development Goals. So you find them here in the middle of the Sustainable Development Goals, this box, transforming our world. And if we look through this lens, we see in fact that there are three types of SDGs. One type relates to areas that need to be transformed. We call them socio-technical systems. And I come to this notion later. These areas are food, energy, healthcare, mobility, water. These are areas of basic needs. And we need to have systems in place to provision for these areas. The second type of SDGs relate to what we call directionalities. So directions for change, like we need to address climate crisis, we need to address the biodiversity crisis, inequality, poverty, all of these aspects. And then we have a third box that relates to the governance, to the way we deal with these challenges. And there's a focus on participation, on networking, on peace. So the main idea of this graph is that if we look through the lens of transforming our world, we can see that we need to use the directionalities to change these systems or these areas, and in this process also consider the governance and make sure that the framework conditions are in place for this change process. Overall, these goals represent for me the idea that we are all developing, all the nations in the world are developing from an older modernist way of looking at development based on the idea of economic growth. We have made this distinction between the developed world and the developing world. But from an SDG perspective, I would argue that what we call the developed world needs even more development than the developing world, because they are embedded in systems that will be very difficult to change, but need to change to address these sustainable development goals and specifically the directionalities. So the world has agreed that we are in a process of transforming our world. That's the first part of the diagnosis. I will come to the second part. And what needs to be transformed are the socio-technical systems. And my thinking is based on STS, and is it led to this thinking is also embedded in a field called sustainability transition studies, which may be seen even as a spin-off of STS. And so these systems that need to provision for these basic needs have not just technological dimensions, they have also social dimensions. They are about user preferences, about industrial strategies, about the culture, the way we experience and perceive and symbolize these basic needs, and about governance and policy. So, for example, for the provision of energy, we have all these elements in place, and they are aligned, and therefore also so difficult to change. These systems are built by actors. So an important aspect of this thinking is that actors are central. They are the ones who interact and build these systems. But it's important to think about how we perceive agency. In my thinking, agents are not free. They are operate in a context. And I would like to refer to this context as a set of institutions in a sense of a set of rule sets. This is similar to what Giddens and others have argued, that actors are enabled and constrained through structure. And these structures can be seen as rules. And this leads to a dominant practice. And actors can do things differently. They are knowledgeable. They are not just following the rules, but it often takes a high cost. And a lot of action, in fact, is unconscious and embedded in the routines of actors. So for a transformation process, it's very important to realize that actors need to become reflexive about these rules and about these structures, and then design ways of navigating them and changing, in fact, a lot of their own assumptions about the world. The basic idea about system change is then that if we want to achieve the sustainable development goals, we should perhaps decenter them, like I did in the figure, and focus on system change. Because if we accomplish system change, build a new energy system, build a new mobility system, a new water management system, we will have impact. The world will be able to address climate change, build a new consumption and lifestyle, address inequality. I say we in my talk, and I'm very much aware of that, because in the world, of course, actors have very different interests, ideologies, and ideas. So the we does not exist as such. Still, for me, it's important to think about the we as a kind of, how would I call that, as a kind of collective will that we may want to help build through the process, realizing that in the end, this is never possible, and there's no we, and there are many opinions and ideas and interest So in the end, it's always a process of divided we stand and not unity in diversity. So how does system change happen? For this, I rely on the multi-level perspective, which was developed at the University of Twente, by Arie Rip, myself, René Kemp, and Frank Geels, of course, who published widely about this. And the idea of the multi-level perspective is that change happens because there are a number of processes that come together. One of the processes is that regime actors, so dominant actors who operate in the system, start to realize they cannot address the challenges anymore, and they need to reorient their behavior. This can be due to pressures of alternative practices, operating in niches, or because of landscape pressures, like climate change. But also urbanization, individualization, globalization, the pandemic. So regime actors need to become aware that they cannot continue with business as usual. And this often takes a long time before dominant actors do that. And it needs a political struggle. Niches are alternative application areas, because in any culture or system, there's always space for alternative action, varieties. And these varieties, when they are nurtured and developed, can become competitors of the dominant practice and scale up. So the theory is about this struggle between niches and regimes, how that is impacted by also landscape trends. So this is my second way of thinking about the world in transition, because a lot of work in the transitions community is about single system dynamics. Recently, together with a number of colleagues, I've been developing this theory and framework about multi-system interaction, and that if you look at our history, that we could argue that the Industrial Revolution was the first transition in which many new systems were built, and they have shaped modern society. And using the ideas of Carlota Perez about surges of development, we have argued that the development of these systems came in waves, and each wave has a turning point. We are now at the fifth wave. And one solution, one way of addressing the sustainable development goals, is trying to integrate them into the current dominant systems. Let's say we can optimize the energy system by adding wind energy to the mix. However, there are many indications that this will not be sufficient, that we need a deeper change. And if we would go that way, if the collective will I talked about, or if the outcome of the political struggles is such that we are able to develop this new path, we can enable a second deep transition, which is comparable to the Industrial Revolution and will completely reshape our societies. And this process can also go, of course, in a complete wrong direction from the Sustainable Development Goals perspective. So I'm not arguing that this will happen. I'm arguing that there is an opportunity for this to happen. And there are already development in niches that point in that direction. So the second deep transition is emerging, but it can still go in many directions. And the work I'm doing is trying to generate a diagnosis on the one hand. So we have done historical work to test whether we can find these waves. And And also how to think about this relationship between the first and second deep transition. But that's not what I want to talk about here in the last part of my talk. I will talk about what can we do about this, because this space, either business as usual or a complete departure, is a big open space here also in the figure. And the question is, how do we exploit this space? The definition of a deep transition is that it is about the interconnection and transformation of several systems in a similar direction. Therefore, it's called deep. But it's also called deep because this change entails a change of what we call meta regimes. So regimes are a set of rules that guide the behavior of actors in single systems. Meta regimes are rules shared across system, so actors from several systems. And it can be seen as a kind of standard or model accepted by many actors across the system. It's a preferred and common sense for improving the systems. These are a number of meta regimes we have identified for the first deep transition. Mass production. In a lot of system, the aim is to mass produce, individual mass consumption, linear production, carbonized production and consumption. And there's also a real tendency and preference for building global value chains instead of local. And if you look at the potential second deep transition meta regimes, I mentioned here four, these are indicative. We may be able to add more, but and we are only at the start of the second deep transition. But here you find the sharing economy, the circular economy, the low carbon production and consumption, and the building of local value chains. So an effective means of trying to deal with the sustainable development goals in the end is about changing the meta rules. Because if these meta rules would be in place and embedded in systems, the normal or regular behavior of actors would be to follow these rules. So it would be to produce local instead of global. They first would look at local options. Then sustainable development would be the kind of normal behavior, the behavior that is expected. Well, I'm experimenting as a researcher with how to enable, how to contribute to such a change process. And for this, I founded, together with a lot of other people, a platform called the Transformative Innovation Policy Consortium. This consortium consists of innovation agents and actors who invest in R&D and science and technology. And they realize that they need to change the way they invest. The current way of investment is either focused on R&D investment and how to do this best in order to contribute to economic growth and development or social problems. This is what I call the first frame of innovation policy, science technology policy. There's a second way of thinking about it, which is related to the idea that even if you do R&D, the results, the knowledge produced may not be used, so you need to enhance the absorptive capacity of actors to use the knowledge. So you need to build relationship between R&D facilities, universities, and industry, for example, and perhaps also civil society. And there's also a strong focus on entrepreneurship, because entrepreneurs are seen as innovators. So this is what I call the second frame. But for addressing the sustainable development goals and enabling the second deep transition, we need to go beyond these two frames and build a third frame, which is based on this notion of transformative change. So the question is, this is the question this consortium strives to address. How can we enable transformative change through science, technology, innovation policy, realizing that this will only be one input, of course, but perhaps an important one, because the new social technical systems we have to build have a strong science and technology component. Well, here you see the countries participating, and you can see it's a really global consortium with South Africa being involved, but also Senegal, Ghana and Kenya, Colombia, China, and the Nordic countries in Europe. But we also now collaborate with Climate Kick, and so we have a pan-European focus. There are two key concepts that we use. One is the idea that science, technology, innovation policy is not about starting up transformation. And in the linear model, part of the first frame, this is often the case. So development starts with basic research, then become applied, and then are introduced in society. This is not what this third frame is based on. It's based on the idea there are ongoing transformations. There are many actors trying to work on transformations already. And the task of the policy maker is to engage with these interactions and with these attempts by actors, and to modulate them and perhaps to redirect them more towards transformative change. So in a way, we argued it's about overcoming transformational failure. And the question is how to do this. And we call for experimental engagement, because it is important to document, trace, reflect about these interactions. And here, the role of researchers is crucial, because they can work with policymakers in organizing these reflections and learning processes, and documenting the change that is happening. And this is what I call transdisciplinary research. So transdisciplinary research is about policymakers participating in the research process and researchers participating in the policy process. And the researchers can, based on this participation, the data they collect and the reflections, theorize, develop new ideas, but also, of course, publish. And the policymakers can reflect on the nature of the policies and how they can improve them. And this process of interaction from a policymaker perspective, we call formative evaluation. So evaluation embedded in the policy process and not done afterwards. So we can navigate during the policy process. And we do this also through a method in which we create a theory of change with transformative outcomes. And I will explain what I mean by this in a minute. So a theory of change is has this structure. So we define inputs, the resources, the actors, all the inputs for the experimental policy engagement. Then we look at activities that are done. Then we look at outputs, deliverables, and then we look at these outcomes. So change in behavior of people and institutions. So in a deeper sense, these outcomes about the changing of rules I discussed before, used by actors in their behavior. And this then will lead to impact, will have impact, and will help to accomplish the mission or the vision set out from the start. So this is a practical way we work. So suppose there is a project, for example, a water management project in South Africa, where actors try to integrate biodiversity and ecological infrastructures into the water management technique and thinking. And this is one of the experiments we do. And so with the policy actors, we construct in the first step their theory of change, their current theory of change, how they think about enabling change, why they do what they do, and using, you know, this scheme of inputs and activities, outcomes. So we try to find out the outcomes the way they perceive them. And then we overlay that, then we have a discussion with them about how transformative is this? Will this really lead to transformative change, and in what sense? How can we improve your theory of change through a set of interactions? This then lead to a MEL, a monitoring and evaluation plan, which is a set of inquiries, the process of data collection, of monitoring progress during the implementation of the policy and feeding this back into the policy design. So this is an iterative process and consists, for example, of learning histories, where we narrate stories about implementation as a kind of reflexive tool. The transformative outcome framework we use is based on the multi-level perspective. So we argue we use three types of outcomes. One are related to niches, the building up of niches. Second one is to the scaling of niches. And the third one is to opening up of these regimes, actors for change. A lot of science and innovation policies are focused on building alternative practices. But for change, it's necessary also to open up regime actors for change. I cannot discuss now all of them in detail, given the time, but I can quickly go through them. For shielding, we, for example, look at the fact whether the protection in the niche is only about the technology dimension, or whether also the users feel protected and able to experiment with the new options. For learning, we look at the fact whether learning is about all the regime dimensions, so not just again about technology, but also about culture, about markets, about industrial strategy, and is deep. So it's focused on enhancing reflexivity and questioning underlying rules. We look at the quality of the network involved, how diverse is the network. Diverse network is necessary, and also whether the network is able to mobilize resources, building up trust. In this process, it's often necessary to have an intermediary actor. Finally, for the first set of outcomes, we look at the role of expectations. They are key for enabling transformation. And again, we look at the diversity, the quality of the expectations, and whether they are aligned across actors. So we are developing indicators for all of these dimensions. So the second part is about expansion of niches. So here we look at upscaling, adoption by users, but that's quite straightforward and important. It's a quantitative measure. And we suggest a threshold for system diffusion, which is different from product diffusion, that we need to, the system need to capture 16% of the future market before the bandwagon, the real expansion, will start. We look at institutionalization, to what extent the rules experimented with in the niche are becoming institutionalized, mainstreamed, more widely accepted, translated in guidelines, policy, handbooks. We look at replication, because often niches operate in small application areas, let's say in one specific town. And we look at ways of replicating it in various other localities. And finally, we look at circulation between all these sites for experimentation, and how to enhance the circulation of people, rules, product, text. And again, we look at the role of intermediary platforms organizing this circulation. For the opening up and unlocking of regimes, we look whether there are policies in place to destabilize dominant regimes. For example, in the car industry, in the 90s, there was this policy that you could only enter the Californian market if you would also produce electrical vehicles. So this was a destabilization of the policy dimension of the regime. It didn't last, partly because the other dimensions did not change. But it's important to have these type of measures in place. Secondly, regime actors also need to go through a process of unlearning about their behaviors, practices, beliefs, and values. So the question is, how is this organized? Are regime actors in a process in which they are challenged in their current behavior? We look at the way niches and regimes interact, whether this is empowering niches and is helping to transform the regimes. And we look at the perceptions among regime actors about the landscape changes. So it really matters, of course, how regime actors perceive the climate crisis or the biodiversity crisis or individualization and how they use this in their behavior and strategizing. So these are 12 transformative outcomes. And what we do in project, we, as I say, we try to see whether these projects or programs, and we also work with private investors, whether these private investors address transformative outcomes. So it's not focused on immediate impact. It's focused on this idea that each project should make a contribution to 1, 2, 3 more of these outcomes. And then you can also look across the portfolio. You can see how a whole range of projects and programs contributes to transformative outcomes. Because at the moment, the problem of a lot of funding structures is that they fund individual projects. So there's what I call a projectification. And we run all these projects, but how they hang together is quite unclear. The method of transformative outcomes is contextual, because what it means needs to be defined for each context and is based on deliberation and active engagement of researchers and policymakers. So in the end, if we ask the question, how can science, technology, innovation, investment facilitate transformation? Here are some pointers. We have to realize that investors are not leading, but they can modulate ongoing transformation through experimental investment engagement. They can work on these transformative outcomes about building up and expanding niches and opening up regimes for change. They can make investment in specific niche opportunities through projects, but they need to look at the connections with other projects. So they need to make them system change positive. So to look at the portfolio level, but the portfolio notion also applies to the idea that we need more collaboration and collective action across public and private investments, because currently they are often not coordinated in any sense. And finally, we need new type of platforms, intermediary actors, where researchers and policymakers can work together. And the Transformative Innovation Policy Consortium is such a platform. And we are also at the brink of establishing a new platform called the Deep Transition Global Investors Panel, where we will bring together a number of investors to experiment with working with transformative outcomes. And all of this has been inspired by STS research. So I'm really thankful to the organizers again for for inviting me to come to speak and discuss this with WTMC. Thank you.